So I should now define measurable functions, but I don't want to go into all the measure theory, so I give you a kind of, let's say, characterization, which we take as our definition, which does exactly, which says exactly what we want of the class of functions which we have. Okay, so what I write here as a definition is not the usual definition for measurable functions, but it's a characterization, which we can also take in our setting as a definition. Measurable functions, and actually, okay, I mean, we have here Borel measurable functions, and what I'm actually saying is that this is the same as bare functions on R, and those can be characterized as functions from R to R, which have what we want. Namely, what do we want? We want to have at least continuous functions, that's clear, and then we want to have a class of functions where we can take pointwise limits. So this means if I have functions in my class and I take a sequence which converges pointwise, then the limit should also be in this class. And that's exactly what I'm saying here. Measurable functions are exactly the smallest class with these properties. So those functions are the smallest class of functions, so which first contains all continuous functions, which contains all continuous functions, and then which in addition is closed under pointwise convergence. And which is closed under pointwise convergence. Because that's what we usually do. I mean, if I have functions, usually I get them as a limit of simpler functions. And in the end, I mean, I usually go back to continuous functions. And for continuous functions, I know how to integrate. So one has to see whether one can extend the integration theory to this class of functions. And maybe as a remark, of course, let me remark that this is a very big class of functions. So in principle, every functions you ever see concretely in your life is a measurable function. So if you want to construct a non-measurable function, then you need the axiom of choice. But this means it's not a very concrete function. So just as a remark is that this is really a very big class, which for all purposes is usually big enough. So each concretely constructed function is measurable. Yeah, but now of course we are interested in extending the integral from continuous function to this class. And so maybe let me just give a very high level and rough survey how this works. So first here are kind of definitions of the relevant constructions. So namely, the main point is, so the definition of this integral f of t dh of t. So h is fixed. That's our given measure, essentially, encoding the measure. But the question is, what can we put here? And the definition which I had before, the Riemann-Stieltjes definition, this was for continuous functions. Good. But now I'm saying that the definition of this guy here can be extended to measurable functions. Can be extended to measurable functions. Yeah, and if you integrate, then of course you always have the problem with infinity, because if you integrate functions which explode, then in principle the integral might make sense, but the value is infinity. Okay, and in principle you can deal with this. The only problem is if you have functions which go to plus infinity and minus infinity, then you might encounter quantities like infinity minus infinity, which don't make sense. So you can include infinity in your calculus, but then you should only look on, let's say, positive functions. And for this, you really have that if you have a measurable function, which is everywhere, or almost everywhere positive, then you really can define such an integral in full generality, but it might happen that the value is plus infinity. But that's okay. This is not a problem. This is a meaningful output. So this means the integral f of t dh of t for all functions, and let's say we first look on real valued functions, and then we look on positive functions. Because I mean, in general, we will have complex valued functions, but we decompose the complex valued into the real part and the imaginary part. So we just have real valued functions, and then the real valued functions we can decompose into essentially the difference between two positive functions. And then, of course, the integral should be linear. So if we deal with both components separately, then we should be able to have a very general theory. Okay, and that's what you're usually doing in this integration theory. So you define this integral here for positive functions, and then you get, of course, a positive number, but you might also get infinity. But this is something which cannot be avoided, and you get a consistent theory for this. So this is always defined and this is called then the Lebesgue-Stieltjes integral, and is called the Lebesgue-Stieltjes yeah, and then you have defined it for positive functions, and now you want to extend it to, let's say, all functions, and for this you should exclude the case where the value is plus infinity, because I mean, if you're only dealing with positive things, then you can allow infinity, but if you deal with things where you might encounter quantities like infinity minus infinity, this leads to contradictions. So this means in full generality we only are interested in functions for which the integral is finite, and this is then what we call integrable functions. So in a for general case we look on functions measurable functions which take on values in C, and we call them integrable, okay, if the basic integral which we can control with the theory which we have up to this point is finite, and what we take is the absolute value of the function, because the absolute value is a real valued function which takes on values only greater or equal to zero. So for this guy is already defined. So we say the function is integrable if the integral over f of t, the absolute value, dh of t, which we already know what this is, how to define it. This is a real number. It could be infinity, but if it is infinity, then we better stay away from this function for general integration, and we only look on functions for which it is finite. Yeah, okay, and usually the space of such functions is called the L1 space. So this here essentially gives you a norm on this space. So the L1 space of R, and of course we have here our measure, so this is dH. You might also write mu here for the measure, but let me write it like this. So this is then given by the functions from R to C, which are integrable in this sense. Yeah. Okay, and of course more general, one can look on the LP spaces. More general, one also considers the LP spaces on R with respect to our measure or with respect to our distribution function. So this is just as before, f from R to C, which are measurable. I mean, here of course also, I always consider measurable functions, because for other functions I cannot say anything about those integrals. So measurable, such that the p-norm is finite. And so the p-norm is the pth root of f of t absolute value. So here I have this, but here I raise this to the power p. So p is something, let's say, bigger or equal to 1. And then I'm integrating this. And again, I'm asking that this is finite. So this is a quantity, positive quantity, which I can integrate always. It might just be infinity. But then LP space is given by those functions for which this is finite. Yeah. Okay, so let me make a few remarks on this setting. So maybe first of all, of course, the integrable functions, the L1 space, are functions for which I can integrate the absolute value. But now, of course, I also want to have an integral over the function itself. Yeah, but one can now convince oneself, that's the basic stuff which one has to do in the theory, that then if I assume that the integral over the absolute value is finite, then the corresponding limits or whatever for the function itself are also finite. So if I'm in the L1 space, then really this ensures that I also have an integral for the function itself. So this means if I have a function in the L1 space, which means by definition that only that I can control the integral over the absolute value, then I also can define the integral f of t dht itself. So this is well defined. And of course, this is now a complex number. So I mean, f is a complex number, so I could decompose this as the sum over the real and the imaginary part, and yeah, reduce it thus to integration theory to real-valued functions. But in any case, this can be defined, so this is a well-defined number. Of course, excluding infinity. So if I'm in R plus, I can include infinity, but if I'm working on R, or if I'm working on C, then infinity should not be included, because this leads to problems. So this guy is well defined, and one has the usual kind of triangle inequality for the integral. So namely that the absolute value of the integral f of t dh of t is less than the integral over the absolute value f of t dht. And this I mean is a quantity which is finite by the fact that f is an L1 function. Yeah, good, okay. So, and I mean, of course, there's much more to say, and of course these LP spaces are nice Banach spaces and I mean you can have a lot of lectures and courses about all those properties in functional analysis and in measure theory. Maybe the only thing which I want to say here is that, of course, the L2 space is for us the most interesting one, because this is the Hilbert space, which we usually are interested in. So the L2 space, so I have all those LP spaces, but L2 is somehow very special because this is a Hilbert space. So L2 is a Hilbert space. With inner product, and of course, I mean, we used this already in our classes for the multiplication and typical operators which we consider, but there usually we had it just for Lebesgue measure. But of course, this is true in general. So this is a Hilbert space with inner product. So the inner product between two functions, f and g, of course, is given by integrating the complex conjugate of f of t times g of t with respect to this measure dh. And again, by the Cauchy-Schwarz inequality, you can essentially show or you see that if you have functions in L2, if f and g are in L2, then this integral here is a finite number. So this is really a well-defined inner product, which has all the properties which it should have. Maybe one has to be a little bit careful, because I want an inner product such that the norm coming from the inner product, which means the square root of the inner product with itself, this should be a norm. And the norm, of course, means that if the norm of a function is equal to zero, the function itself should be equal to zero. And this causes a little bit of, not really problems, but a bit of notational headache in this context, because I mean we have here functions which are measurable functions, and of course those functions, if I really consider them as functions, they are defined everywhere. Okay, and I can have functions which are zero in many places, but they might not be zero at some places, and if the measure of these places are zero, then this integral here is zero. So this means in this context, one is somehow forced to do what we really are doing in a measure theoretic context, namely we are identifying functions which differ on a set of measures zero. So in a very formal way, functions are now not really defined everywhere, but only almost everywhere. And the reason is that if the difference of two functions with respect to the LP norm or the L2 norm which we have here, if this is equal to zero, then those functions should be identified, because for our integration theory we cannot distinguish between them. And that's what you usually are doing in such a context, so in the LP spaces, functions which differ on a set of measures zero, they are identified. So, but that should hopefully also be clear. So one identifies two functions if they agree almost everywhere with respect to the measure dh, which I have here.